About spectral geometry in Subramanian manifold, but I will stay in the simplest case, which is a 3D contact, okay? And you will see some results and mainly two conjectures, which I will try to motivate. So for people who want to work, there is a lot to do. So first transparent, you will see my collaborators, it's Luc and Emmanuel. Nothing more to say, you see, are in good shape. I start with a definition of a contact structure and the rib vector cell. Here it's Georges Rib, which were professor in Strasbourg. So M is a 3D manifold. A contact structure is a round two subbundle of the tangent bundle, which is defined as a kernel of a one form, but we can change one form, okay? And the property is that alpha wedge d alpha is a volume form. So in some sense, alpha is maximally non-degenerate. And if we give alpha, not only d but alpha, then there is a associated vector field, which is called the rib vector field, and is defined by, if you evaluate alpha, you get one, and if you take the inner product with r with the alpha, you get zero. Give a uniquely defined, it's in the thesis of Georges Rib. And this vector field is transversal to the distribution, okay. And what will be very important in what follow, that there is an Hamiltonian interpretation of the Rib vector field. I will denote by sigma the orthogonal in the cotangent space, namely the space, the set of covectors which vanish on D. It's a symplectic subcone of the cotangent bundle because alpha is a contact form. And now, if I define a function rho from this cone into R plus, by rho of S alpha is absolute value of S. So it gives you some Hamiltonian on the symplectic manifold, and you can look at the Hamiltonian dynamic of rho, which is homogeneous of degree zero, invariant by dilation, and the orbits of this Hamiltonian vector field project onto the Rebe orbits. So it's the same thing because it's homogeneous of them. We will denote by R sub T the Rebe flow on sigma or S of sigma. What is it will occur several times if we have vector bundle, S of that bundle is a sphere bundle, is a quotient of the bundle by the action of R plus. So it's a set of half lines in the bundle. Okay, it's a compact set. Now we come with a Subramanian metric. We give a metric, a smooth metric on the distribution. This defines the distance by minimizing the length of horizontal curves, tangent to D, okay, that we all know. The geodesics with speed one are the projections on M of the Hamiltonian orbits of the dual metric. The dual metric is defined as follow. You take a covector X xi, you restrict xi to the distribution at the point X, and you take the square of the norm. And you define the unit bundle, unit cotangent bundle, which is a set of covectors for which the G star is equal to one. And then the projections of the Hamiltonian orbits inside this unit bundle are the geodesics, exactly. And we can assume that D is oriented. And this way, we can choose a contact form, alpha sub g, which satisfy that the differential of alpha sub j restricted to D, which is a non-degenerate, is exactly the volume with respect to the Riemannian metric. This defines a Ribb vector field, R sub j, which is the Ribb vector field associated to alpha j. And this vector field will be the main actor in what follows. Don't hesitate to interrupt me if there is some problem, but I guess that all is this is well known, that there is no new statement in this. Okay. The fibers of the unit cotangent bundles, the size, are cylinders. In the Riemannian case, there are two spheres, but in this case, there are cylinders, so they are not compact. And the Ribb flow plays the role of a compactification of the geodesic flow. The cosphere bundle, namely the sphere bundle of the cotangent bundle, can be identified as a union of the cylinder U star X and the sphere bundle of sigma, which is the orthogonal of the distribution. The geodesic flow lives on the U star X, while the Ribb flow lives on S of sigma. So it's a kind of compactification. You are, in some sense, you add to U star X 2 points at infinity. Okay. So basic example. So this one is, I guess, well known, is the Heisenberg group, which you can give in different presentation, but I take this one. It's R3 with this law, non-commutative law, and we choose a lattice like that. And it gives you a subgroup, a discrete subgroup of the Heisenberg group. And you can look at the quotient R3 over gamma, which is a compact sub-Riemannian manifold. And we choose the metric so that dx and dy minus x dz is an orthonormal basis. Then the Ribb flow is d over d, is dz bar, dz. Okay. And I will speak of the Laplacian, but in this case, it's very simple. It's the sum of square of x and y. And you can compute the spectrum. One gets the union of the eigenvalues of the flat torus R2 over this lattice. And the most important part of the spectrum, which is the set of integers of the form M times 2L plus 1. Not all integers are like that. Even integers are not like that. And the multiplicity is quite large because if you have a number like that, maybe it can be decomposed in several ways. That way, so the multiplicity can be very large. The length spectrum is a spectrum of is a set of lengths of closed geodesics, can be easily computed. Is given by 2p square root of 2n, where n is an integer. A more complicated example is the magnetic fields over a Riemannian surface. So I look at a principal bundle M over a Riemannian surface. It means that you have a free action of S1 onto this three-dimensional manifold. And we assume that this bundle is equipped with an Hermitian connection whose horizontal distribution is ordered. Another way to say that D is orthogonal to the orbits of the S1 action as is also invariant by the S1 action. You can compute the connection, which is a two-form on X, and you assume that it does not vanish, then the distribution is compact. And we can take for J the pullback on D of the metric H on X by P, and the curvature is a two-form, which is the magnetic field. One introduces the magnetic scalar, which is B, the two form divided by the volume form of the metric H. And the SR, the sub-Riemannian metric, is invariant by the S1 action. This gives an invariant momentum, which is interpreted as the electric charge. the geodesics of MDG of momentum A project onto the trajectories on X with the magnetic field B and the electric charge A. So it's the same, okay. And the rib vector field in this case is B times d theta. D theta is the infinitesimal action minus B euro, which is the horizontal lift of the Hamiltonian vector field of B with respect to the symplectic form B. It means that the projection of the rib vector field is tangent to the level sets of small b. A third example is Liouville. Again, you take a Riemannian surface. M is a unit cotangent bundle. D is the kernel of the Liouville form, xi dx plus eta dy. And we take on D some metric so that alpha g, there are many choices, alpha g equal this Liouville form. Then the rib vector field identifies with, or the rib flow identifies with the geodesic flow of the metric H. So you see there are many examples. I will skip this one. It's related also to complex analysis, but I will skip. And I will describe the geodesics of this 3D Subriemannian manifolds. And it's called spiraling. In fact, I will show you that the geodesics of large momenta, the momenta is large if you go to infinity in the unit bundle, in the cylinders. And those geodesics, they are spiraling around the rib orbit. In the case of Heisenberg, it's quite easy to show. So the G star is just a symbol of the Laplacian, it's like that. You can rewrite it this way. So you divide by absolute value of zeta, and you can compute the Poisson bracket. So the Poisson bracket of U and V is one, and the Poisson bracket of zeta and U square plus V square is zero. So it means that E is an harmonic oscillator which is commuting with zeta, and zeta is exactly, or absolute value of zeta is exactly the rib Hamiltonian. So the dynamic is decoupled, and we have this way to write it, which is G star is rho E. Rho is a rib Hamiltonian, and I is a harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian, and both are commuting. So this way you can compute the Hamiltonian flow, which is rho d over d theta. So this d over d theta is in the UV plane, it's a rotation, plus the rib Hamiltonian, and you get the flow. You assume that you are in the unit cotangent bundle, or you have this identity, rho e equal one. And gt of sigma, so sigma is a point in sigma, and u and v are like that. Then you get r. R is the rib flow. So you get the rib flow at time it over 2 evaluated at the point sigma. And you take a rotation, a very fast rotation, eit over large e, u plus iv. And as E is going to zero, rho is going to infinity because of this equation. And you see that the geodesics are spiraling very fast around the rib orbit. So it means that you have helices, and the speed along the rib orbit is quite slow, while the speed of rotation is rather large. And we can extend this using Birkhoff normal forms. And for simplicity, I assume that the bundle D horizontal distribution is topologically trivial, otherwise it's already it's more local. Okay. Then there exists a canonical transformation of a conic neighborhood of sigma in the contingent space onto a conic neighborhood of sigma times zero in sigma times R2. So sigma is already symplectic and R2 is equipped with dV wedge du. And so that the restriction of key to sigma is identity times zero. So key preserves sigma. And you have this normal form, which is G star on C, composed with chi minus one. There is a full expansion, sum with respect to G, rho G of sigma, so sigma is again in big sigma, E to the G, plus some remainder term, which is very small if I over rho is small, namely along sigma. I call that I equals zero corresponds to sigma. And rho G is homogeneous of degree two minus G. Rho one is a Hamiltonian, is a Reb Hamiltonian, and I is again the harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian. Using this normal form, in fact, there are more precise normal forms which are more local. You can remove some terms, but this one is global, so it's somewhat better in order to understand the closed geodesics. I will skip this because it's too long. And this way, we get an approximation of the Hamiltonian vector field, and what is more important, an approximation of the geodesic flow, which is exactly the same formula as for the Heisenberg group, but now it's only an approximation. This approximation is valid as E is going to zero for a time T is big O of one over I. So this time is as large as you want, but it's bounded, I T over two. And here you have the very fast rotation. It means that the geodesic of large momenta, they again spiral, but now around the rib orbits. Not that it is already well known by physicists and many people. In the case of magnetic field, when the electric charge is large, the magnetic orbits in 2D, they spiral around the level lines of the magnetic field. And similar things are known in 3D, but I will not speak today on 3D, which is more complicated. Periodic geodesics, if the Birkhoff normal form is convergent, it may happen sometimes in some cone, then we can show the existence of a family of closed geodesics which are spiraling around the closed rib orbit. It's known in dimension three that there are always some periodic orbits for the rib flow. It was a conjecture of Weinstein. And the if you fixed L, some small L, and then for K large, you have some closed geodesics of length, this one, 2 square root KL T0 pi. This family of geodesics, they cover L times the rib closed orbit, and they turn around K times. Okay. And though it's not very, it's quite easy to prove. And it leads to conjecture, which is the first conjecture of my lecture, is that if you have a Reb orbit, which is non-degenerate, it means that the Poincaré map is has no eigenvalue equal to one, then there exists infinitely many closed geodesics spiraling around this Rebbe orbit. It would be very nice to prove this, but I was not able, we were not able to do that. So if somebody has a way to do it, it would be very interesting. Okay. Now I start the second part, which is about the Laplace operator, which is for me my main interest in this business. So in order to define the Laplacian, in fact, there are many Laplacians, but they share all the same properties. We choose a smooth density dx on the manifold, and we have the Subriemannian metric. The Laplacian is a Friedrich extension on L2 with respect to this measure of the quadratic form, which is integral over M, G star df, and this. If you start with an orthonormal basis of D locally, then the Laplace operator is x star x plus y star y, where star is the adjoint with respect to dx. So it's minus x square minus y square plus lower over term. And the lower order terms, they depend on the choice of dx. The symbol, the principal symbol of delta is g star, so it's independent of dx, which vanishes exactly on sigma. It means that delta is not an elliptic operator, but it is still sub-elliptic. It means that if delta u has some Sobolev regularity, then U is a bit more regular in the Sobolev scale. So it's a famous theorem by Ermander. And hence, if the manifold is compact, we get a discrete spectrum, lambda k, with an orthonormal basis of eigenfunction phi k. And we will be interested in the what can be said of this object. First, there is a famous Weyl law, which still holds. So you define the counting number of eigenvalues, and we have an asymptotic as lambda goes to plus infinity, which is integral on M of alpha j wedge d alpha j. So you remark that this number is independent of dx. So this measure is depends only on the Subriemannian metric divided by 32 times lambda square. If you were in the Riemannian case, it would be lambda to the three half. Okay, so there are more eigenvalues than in the Riemannian case, but because the operator is not elliptic and the unique bundle is not compact. If M is a tree sphere, then this number is what was introduced by some people, but there is a famous paper of Arnold. It's an asymptotic up invariant. This invariant, the invariant of the Rebbe vector field, which is a way, what is this of invariant? You take two points, you look at very long orbits of the Rebbe vector field, you close by short curves, you look at the linking number because you are in S3, you look at the limit as the lengths of the orbits are very large, then you average on the manifold and you get this number. Okay, it means that already at the level of the Weyl law, you get some information on the Rebbe vector field. Then we can say something more precise, which is quantum limits. quantum limits is something which say some property of localization, of micro-localization of eigenfunctions for large k. So you take a pseudo-differential operator of degree zero and principal symbol small a, because it's homogeneous, it's defined on the sphere bundle. And you look at the quantities a, phi k, phi k. If a were the multiplication by some function, it's just the integral of this function time phi k squared. It will give you some information on m, but here you need some information on the cotangent space, the phase space. And you can prove that if you take subsequences, these quantities, they converge to some to the integral of some measure on the sphere bundle for some probability measure. So in general, you have many, many quantum limits. And a big problem already in Riemannian geometry is to give some properties, some general properties of the quantum limits. In Riemannian geometry, it's well known that the quantum limits are invariant by the geodesic flow. Here, the situation is a bit more complicated. So it's a result with Hilleret and Trela. Any quantum limit can be decomposed into two parts where mu infinity is supported by S of sigma, so it lives at infinity of the cylinders and is invariant by the red flow. And the other part is on U star X and invariant by the geodesic flow. Moreover, most of eigenfunctions, for most of eigenfunctions, the quantum limits are supported by S of sigma. It means that mu infinity vanishes in general. And if the red flow is ergodic, then there is a unique quantum limit for a sequence of density. It's called quantum ergodicity. Okay. So in order to say more, we need to extend our Birkhoff normal form to quantum Birkhoff normal form. And for that, we need to quantize the Ribe Hamiltonian, which is a functions of homogeneous of degree one on a conic symplectic manifold. And by chance, there is a theory which is called Toeplitz operator, which was developed by Boutin-Monvel and Guillemin. Here you see Boutin-Monvel and here you see Guillemin. They were working in MIT, I guess, about this Toeplitz operators. So it's exactly like pseudo-differential operators, but the symplectic cone is no more the cotangent bundle, but it's any symplectic cone. And micro-locally, it's exactly the same calculations with Poisson bracket and so on. So it's a more precise definition. So you take a subcone of the star M, you define from it an Hilbert subspace of L2, which consists of distribution whose wavefront set is included in sigma. You define the orthogonal projector. And if you take a pseudo-differential operator on M, you define a Toeplitz operator, which is TA is pi A, where pi is this projection. It's an operator, an unbounded operator S sigma. And this set of operators is in fact a graded algebra, which satisfies exactly the same properties than the pseudo-differential calculus. And the symbol, the principal symbol of TA is simply the restriction to sigma of the symbol of R. So the rules are exactly the same. You can't forget everything. The rules are exactly the same. And now there is a quantum Birkhoff normal form, which looks like that. So this delta zero is not exactly delta because you have to restrict to some conic neighborhood of sigma. Is sum of Rg times omega to the g plus some remainder. So Rg are Toeplitz operator. And if you look at principal symbol, it's exactly the same as before. You have G star. Here you have what he was calling Rg and here I to the g. But now you can do that for the full symbol. And the remainder is small along sigma. I will not, it's quite technical to describe what does it mean, but I will describe some implication. I take, because the operators are commuting, this one operates on H sigma and this one on L2 of R, or it's an harmonic oscillator. You can look at a fixed eigenvalue 2L plus 1 of the harmonic oscillator, and you get some operators which are delta L, which are this one, okay? For each value of L, give you, you choose the corresponding eigen function of omega, and you get this kind of operator. And the principal symbol is always the same, is 2L plus 1 times rho. R1 is rho, but the other are different. And we get the sequence of eigenvalues of delta L. We call that a Landau cluster because it's related to Landau levels for magnetic fields. And if you take the eigenvalue lambda k L of delta L, you have a subsequence. So you fix L, you have a subsequence mu j k of eigenvalue of the Laplacian, which are lambda k L plus some very small remainder term as k is going to infinity. In other words, each sequence, the sequence of eigenvalues of delta L give a subsequence of eigenvalues of our Laplace operator modulo a very small remainder term. You can do that even if you give a finite number of value of L, but you can, it's not uniform as L is going to infinity. Unfortunately, it will be very nice, but it's not the case except maybe in the Heisenberg case. And now the last part of my lecture, how much time do I have still?
So I think 15 minutes, maybe more, since we started a little bit late.
Okay, so 20, something like that.
Yeah.
Okay. So the last part will be about trace formulae, which is some work which is not not finished, not written, but I guess it's okay. So if you were lost, you can start again because it's a different story, not completely independent, but somewhat. What is a trace formula? You want to compute the trace of some function of the Laplace operator. You do that in two ways. One way is you take the sum of eigenvalues, and another way, you try to evaluate the Schwarz kernel of this operator, and you compute the trace as the integral on the diagonal of this Schwarz kernel. Okay. And in order to compute this, you can use any tools you want. Group theory, for example, if you want to look at Zellberg trace formula, you can use group theory. Or if you want to only to have approximate trace formula, you can use partial differential equation. The main functions F which are used are the exponential x minus tx, which correspond to the trace of the heat equation, And usually people look at what happens as t is going to zero. And the Schrödinger trace you take now, instead of real t, you can a complex z, which real part strictly positive, give you more information. You can look at what is called the wave trace, which is a x I t square root of x. And in this case, in case of it and Schrödinger, you look at what happens as z over or t is going to zero. In this case, you are looking at singularities as a function of t. Basic trace formula comes from the Poisson summation formula. You start with a lattice in Rd, and you call gamma star the dual lattice. Then you have this formula, very beautiful formula, which is sum E minus 4 pi square gamma star square t is 1 over 4 pi t d over 2, sum on gamma. And this formula can be interpreted as follows. The left-hand side is the heat trace because the eigenvalue of the flat Laplacian are 4 pi square gamma star square. And here, the right-hand side, this gamma norm gamma square are the lengths of closed geodesics. And it was, okay, so it's a starting point. Here you have Poisson. Okay, so the people in the 70s, like me and other people, they extend this formula to compact Riemannian manifold as asymptotic formula. Okay, here is a main actors from this extension. It's me, it's Deuster-Matt and Guillemin. This Schrödinger trace was extended by myself using the Schrödinger approach and said it's going to zero, and then by Chazarin and Deuster-Matt-Guillemin just after. Both approaches that show that the length spectrum, already in the case of in the Riemannian case, is generically a spectral invariant. It means that if you know the spectrum of the Laplace operator on the Riemannian manifold, compact, then you know the length spectrum. So it was important with respect to the Katz problem, can you hear the shape of the drone? We'll try to get such formulae for the sub-Riemannian manifolds. And first, there is a very nice formula, which is here, which correspond to the Heisenberg, to the first example, namely a compact cushion of the Heisenberg group. So on the left-hand side, you have the spectral part. Remember, the eigenvalue were 2L plus 1M and the multiplicity. And using the Poisson summation formula, you get this formula, okay? So it's, and I will show you how to interpret this formula. I will show you that this formula, in this case, it contains the length of closed geodesics, but also the periods of the rib flow. They are not, maybe you don't see that, but I will show you. There is another trace formula which is due to Melrose. This time, this formula is already in the sub-Riemannian case in 3D, in the context of my presentation. So he looks at the wave trace and he showed that the singular support is included in the spectrum, in the set of lengths of closed geodesics. So it's exactly the same as for the Riemannian case, with the same formula for the singularities. And there is also a trace formula for delta L, for the Toeplitz operator. In the book by Boutet, Monvel, and Guimard, they show that you have a formula which is delta L is a first order Toeplitz operator. It's like a first order pseudo-differential operator. And you have a trace formula. And the corresponding orbits are the closed rib orbits. The periods are T gamma, the periods of the rib orbits, divided by 2L plus 1. So if you take all values of L, it's a very dense set. But nevertheless, there are some singularities which are related to the period of rib orbits. Then you can look again at the same formula. And first, you look at real values of t going to zero. This term gives you again the Weyl law. And you get exponentially small term of the form x minus L square over 4t, and the L sub n are exactly the length of closed geodesics. It's because you look at the expansion, it's an exponentially small term with this coefficient. So you get exactly, so you get from this formula, you recover the length of closed geodesics. Now you can look also at the boundary value of the formula as real part of Z is going to zero, and you get a dense family of poles, which are the poles of the zeros of the denominator, which are exactly the periods of the rib divided by 2L plus 1. So this formula contains everything you want to know. This led me to a second conjecture that the red periods are spectral invariants of the Sub-Riemannian Laplacian. The first clue is that you start from Melrose formula, you get the length of closed geodesics, and you apply the first conjecture, which gives you something related to the red orbits. And the second hint is that you decompose delta morally as a direct sum of delta L. You apply the Boutet-Monvel-Guillemin formula to H delta L and give you the rib orbits. So I consider that this conjecture is quite strong. It's really a conjecture, but I'm not able to prove it. Otherwise, I will have put theorem and not the conjecture in this line. So I guess I have finished my presentation. Again, I'm very sorry for the delay, for being late. Okay, so thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Yves. Okay, so maybe you can stop recording.